fine.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this glorious winter's Saturday afternoon here in the northeast corner of the world's most magnificent country, South Africa. We have our problems, but we have far more going for us than we do against us. And there we have three vultures. Now, those vultures are looking down at a carcass with hungry eyes, the carcass of a young buffalo murdered in its infancy by some lions yesterday evening. Hello, my name is James Henry. On camera today is David. Hello, David. Okay. David has been a little bit under the weather today, but we've dosed him up with a whole lot of... I've been reading up about birds. David has been dosed up with a whole lot of medication. Do you feel okay, David?
Feeling great.
Wonderful. On the other vehicle, the buffalo-like figure of Myron Sorrell, and he's being filmed by the increasingly hairy figure of Wim Doornbruch. He's now resembling a sort of hobbit at the moment. He's been fixing his car all day and is very happy to be out in the wilderness with us today. Louise is in the final control, in my ear, and twiddling the knobs. We've got Chelsea from Vermont with us. Now, you're on a live safari, in case you're wondering what Saturday afternoon is bringing you today. Yes, live safari, that's what I said, from the middle of the iconic Kruger National Park. And that means you must talk to us. Please, please talk to us. Hashtag safari live or questions at wildearth.tv. There go the birds. See the vulture going out there? I don't think it's going to land. Now, I don't know if the lions are still there. We've just come into this area. Let's go and have a quick look-see if the lions are there. Those vultures won't go onto the ground with the lions there, but they're also very nervy around us. So let's go and see. Welcome to it. The lions were just over here this morning. And I've got no idea if they're still here. I imagine they would be. They were very full of beefalo. I think there might be some beefalo left. And I also would like your help in identifying them. We think they were Nkuhuma lionesses. We're not 100% sure, I don't think, because the Nkuhuma pride has basically exploded into 100 different pieces because they are all giving birth, seemingly. Right, well, they were in here earlier this morning. Now, what you can often do is drive into this area, into an area like this, and suddenly find that you're almost parked on top of a corpulent lion. Just do a little bit of a drive off road here. I'll be absolutely astounded if there isn't a lion lying here in the shade somewhere. They may have gone down to the water. David, you haven't seen one, have you? All right, well, while we look around here, everybody, let's go across to Byron and find out what he's doing. I think he's on his way to Cheetah Plains. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Safari Live. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this afternoon, we've got Wim. Hi, Wim. Great to have you all with us again on this beautiful, beautiful South African winter's afternoon. James is correct. I'm heading off exploring down to Cheetah Plains. I've not been yet, so I'm getting to see a new area.
Sorry about that, everybody. I'm not sure why the signal's gone. It must be Byron. You know, he's such a beefy fellow. He's obviously putting the signal off. I don't know what's going on here. I'm astounded that these lions aren't here. There was one lying right there when we came back from drive today, and now it has moved. So what we'll do is just have a little squiz around here, and if we don't find one lying in the shade almost immediately, we will go off to the treehouse dam and see if they aren't lying there. But I can't imagine they've been gallivanting too far from here, given the size of the belly on the lioness I saw this morning.
Yeah, well, it's 22 degrees Celsius, 75 degrees Fahrenheit, which is not as hot as it might be. It certainly has been hotter. I thought I saw a lion, but I didn't. It has been hotter, and it was very, very chilly this morning, I must say. But it's such a glorious day. Okay, we're going to go down to the water, and then we'll come back and knock around in the bush here. But I'm pretty sure... Well, I mean, they wouldn't have gone far, I don't think. So I find this very strange. But let's have one more look inside here, just quickly. I just think it's too odd that they've gone too far. And I see no remains of the carcass. But they were feeding right here. Let's scan under the bushes. A little bit forward. A couple of fresh elephant tracks around. I wonder if some elephants didn't come past here and perhaps give them what for and send them scuttling off into the bushes. No. I see nothing in the way of lions. This is the first time in the history of lions that they've actually moved during the middle of the day. Well, at least it adds to the mystery of things. Now we're definitely going to go off down to the water. I'm absolutely astounded. Hello, Becca Dorset. You're a new viewer. Wonderful to have you with us. Thank you for joining us, A, and B, thank you for asking a question. You want to know what we are doing? Well, Becca, we're on a live safari in the middle of the Kruger National Park. That's the sort of macro scale of what we're doing. What I'm doing right now is looking for lions that were here this morning. They were eating a little buffalo. The buffalo seems to have been devoured in its entirety. And there were some vultures here, obviously looking for some scraps that are no longer. And so now we're going to go down to a waterhole, Becca, and see if we can see the lions from there. No idea where they've gone. There are a few tracks in here, but these are old tracks from another sighting. So, Becca, this is what we do twice a day, every day. We go on a safari through here. We broadcast it live over the interweb to, well, wherever you are in the world. And we have viewers from Finland and Australia and New Zealand and India, and many in the United States, a couple in the United Kingdom. We've had one from Hungary, we've had one from Tanzania, we've had one from Brazil, or a few from Brazil. So that's what we do, basically, and we'd love to hear from you. And keep asking us questions about Africa, South Africa, the Kruger, safaris, and any of the creatures we might be seeing. Hashtag Safari Live, obviously you know that because you sent through a question. And Costa Rica, we've also apparently had a few viewers. Canada, obviously. Throughout the English-speaking world and some parts of the non-English-speaking world. Alrighty. I see no tracks, and there is a quite a nice game path, which is a path that the... animals might make from constant use, and it does head from where we were down towards a waterhole over here called Treehouse Dam. Let's go and see if they're down there. Oops. Bit bouncy. So, the Nkuhuma pride at the moment, everyone, is the five lionesses. At least two of them are off with babies. One of them, we think, is possibly also doing the same, leaving just these two on their own. And whether they're pregnant or not, or have been mating, I'm not sure. But the pride will no doubt reconstitute itself once the cubs are about 6 weeks old. Then the pride will normally be introduced to the little cubs, and they'll all start to move as a unit again. But while they're all giving birth, they are going to be split up like this, and I'm amazed that those two lionesses managed to take a buffalo out of a herd.
That's quite impressive for two lionesses to have achieved. Because normally they'd be chased off. So few lions would be chased off by very big buffaloes. Now, Auntie Lynn, you want to know where the buff carcass could be? I don't know, because I didn't see it. And from the fatness of the lion that I saw, I would have said that they probably finished it, or most of it. But it was right there. I mean, they were feeding right where we were parked. So I don't know where it is or what's happened to, you know, the remainder of it, the head, a couple of small bones. Maybe it was a really, really small calf and they devoured the whole thing. That's not impossible. If it was a newborn, they would have eaten everything. They would have eaten all the bones and everything. Maybe leaving one or two little pieces of vertebra around. But what is marvelous about this, of course, is that we don't know what's going to happen. We will probably have to track them. That could take all day. It could take another couple of minutes. Let's see. That's the joy of being out here, of course. On this proper winter's day. And of course, to most of you, calling what I'm calling winter now, winter is ridiculous. Many of you have got far worse winters than this. So this is quite interesting. Michelle in Sweden, you were at the lion sighting this morning and you say there were definitely two Nkuhuma lionesses. One of them with a spotty nose is the lactating mother from the Torchwood area. So that really is very interesting. Thank you for that. Here we are at the waterhole where there is not much water and nor are there any lions seemingly. While we look around here, Byron seems to have retrieved his signal. Let's go back across to him and find out what he's going to do this afternoon.
That's right, James. Thank you. I did get some signal back and we are on Cheetah Plains at the moment. It's a very interesting story and situation that James has got going on there with those lionesses that have disappeared. I'm not too sure what could have happened. We did hear hyena this morning in the area while we were sitting with them. So I wonder if they weren't chased off and maybe the hyena took the carcass and ran away. It's interesting that the vultures were sitting there though, because it was a very small carcass, and usually they prefer something bigger where they are guaranteed some scraps. So I'm not too sure what happened there. I'm sure James will work it out shortly. So Viam and I are really just exploring this afternoon, having a look at this different terrain. As I said, I haven't been down here yet or before at all. So it's a new area for me, and it's always great. You never know what you're going to see or what the terrain holds. So if I get lost, then who knows? I'm sure we'll find our way back though. Oh, elephant up ahead. Just caught a glimpse of one. Let's have a look. So Philo has asked, is this really live? Yes, you are 100% live from the middle of South Africa, or the northeastern part of South Africa rather. Let's just have a look quickly. Here's the elephant. Oh, there we go. Looks like a young bull. Can you see it? I see another one off to the left, just moving through the thicket. Might be a bit tricky for Viam to get. It's moving off there. But yes, Philo, we are completely live. What we are seeing, you are seeing immediately. There's no breaks, there's no cuts, which is just incredible. We are very fortunate to be able to showcase Africa at its best and at its wildest to all of you around the world. This elephant seemed to be moving through this thicket a little bit. Let's just see if I can get you another view quickly. Look like two younger bulls that are moving around together. Let me see. one. This is quite thick, yeah? Hang on. There you can just see him moving through this dense combretum thicket. But beautiful colors in the bush at the moment. Look at all these yellows and greens and oranges. I mean, I've mentioned it a few drives now, but it really just is such beautiful scenery. And these dry leaves, you can actually hear the elephant moving through the bush as they are walking past. Can't see them, but I can hear them very clearly. Just as they are scraping against the trees, those dry leaves make a beautiful sound against their hide. That was a nice surprise. There you can have a look. Look how dry those leaves are at the moment. We have had a very dry year so far, but there is still a bit of food around for these animals. And animals like elephant know exactly where to find all the good food. And there is still some water, so no drought as of yet. Anyway, let us continue. But what a great little surprise. As I was saying, you never know what you're going to bump into. And we bump straight into an elephant, or two elephant rather. I see a few more tracks. There's possibly a herd that moved through earlier. Occasionally you can get these younger bulls following herds like that. It's only really the dominant bulls, the big dominant bulls, that will try and mate with females. So while we are heading out further into cheetah plains and looking for some clearings, why don't you go and see what James has got, or if he's got an update about those lions.
James unfortunately does not have an update, everybody. I had no idea where those lions went. I may have to go off and have a look on foot. But interestingly, that report all the way from Sweden, that was one of the mothers, is interesting, because maybe she's gone back towards Torchwood. I would have expected to see one of her tracks though by now if she'd done that. So she might be going. Torchwood, everybody, is a property to the east of us where we are not allowed to go, but the animals are obviously free to come and go as they please. I'm just going to keep an eye on the road to see if there are any tracks. So if I don't look at you when I'm talking to you, I'm not being rude, I promise. David, there's a very nice shot of a forked-tailed drongo which has just avoided us. There it is. Oh, I forgot we don't have the super zoom. That's it there. Very nice. And you will notice the absolute peace of this afternoon. It really is quite fantastic. Just looking for little insects lurking about the ground or flying past. They do hawk insects, and that's why they've got that forked tail. It's very effective. It helps them to stop suddenly in the air, twist round, turn, and then land again. Very aggressive little fellows are the fork-tailed drongos. There it goes. All right. Oops, you can see that hole. All right, so let's watch the ground and just see if there aren't any lion tracks coming down this way. There certainly weren't any going down towards the waterhole like I expected there to be. So the kill was just over there in the block there. So they went down to the water. They should have crossed this road at some stage. Otherwise, they may have just gone further into the bush to rest. And they could have been very close by, you know, to where we saw them. Now, Tasha, you have fallen victim to one of the great misconceptions of the African wilderness and lions. You say that I mentioned that there were two lionesses in this pride this morning and no male, and you thought there was always a male with them to protect them. Now, one of the misconceptions not helped at all by the magnificent film, Great Story, Terrible Biology, that was The Lion King, is that a male lion is part of the pride. He is not part of the pride at all, Tasha. The male lion is a extraneous part of the pride. So the pride is the female, normally related, and their youngsters. The male can, normally a coalition of males, so unlike the Lion King, it would be Scar and Mufasa, they would be mates together normally, and they take over territory together and dominate that territory, and within their territory, Tasha, there would be one or two or maybe even three pride territories. There's a lion track, but that's from last night. So, Tasha, the males are not part of the pride. They protect the pride's territories as a whole from marauding males, and that helps the cubs not to be killed by new males coming into the area. But they're not part of the pride. So, and in fact, for the females, they'd almost rather not have the males with them, because a male lion out here, quite apart from being the noble beast portrayed in The Lion King, is actually the greatest scavenger out here. He will steal far more food than he ever actually eats. And he'll steal it from everybody, from the prides, from the hyenas, from anyone. Now, let's go across back to Byron. He's managed to find some elephants, and they seem to be quite thirsty.
Look at this, everyone. A beautiful herd of elephant. Remember while we were driving, we saw those other two. I said there were definitely tracks of a herd that's come through, and those two bulls might have been following. I think that's exactly what's happened here. They are following this herd, and look at that little baby playing in the water. He's tiny, tiny, tiny little baby. Beautiful calf. Oh, this is fantastic. I'm in my element now. These are one of my favorite animals, and it's so great to be able to see them at a waterhole. And they are really enjoying it. It's been a nice warm day. We've had a few cool days the last two or three, so it's been really warm today. Now enjoying this water and a bit of mud. Look at that. Oh, this is fantastic. Look how tiny that little one is. Just off to, there we go. Look at that. Oh, just so cute. At that age, that little elephant does not know how to use its trunk yet. Probably, you see, trying to drink with its mouth. It can't use its trunk yet and to pour the water into its mouth. So it will just put its head right down. It will definitely still be suckling from its mom, from that female that's close to it, but it will start to try and learn how to drink water. Ah. So Aaron in Florida has asked how we can tell the difference between an elephant cow and a bull. So Aaron, one of the first things you can look at is if you see an elephant like this, if you look up at that forehead, let's see that one, that, yeah, there we go, VM is just focused on that there. That is a female. So you can see, just hang on, there's a beautiful female getting quite close to us on the right with the baby. Look at that, very close to us. So this female right here in front of us, if you have a look at her head over there, see it's a very sharp, angular shape, and that is typical of females. Males have got a much rounder forehead, and that would be the first thing you could look at. The other thing is have a look where this younger elephant is suckling from. The females have their mammary glands under the front legs. You might just be able to see it over there. Yep. That is also a sign that you could look for. The males obviously do not have that. Wow, this is incredible. Look how she's smelling. There's a buffalo skull, an old buffalo skull down there. That female is just smelling it. You know, I think elephants are incredibly intelligent, and they can probably still just smell or trying to work out what that skull is. Very interesting behavior. See how she's hanging around this carcass. There's a lot of bones here. It's definitely from a buffalo kill. Still just smelling. But they're very close to us now, about 5 meters away, 6 meters. This is very, very special. Quite a few of them still drinking. Those just moving off probably had enough water. And what they'll do is they'll just continue moving around and looking for food, feeding while the rest of these finish up. This is such a beautiful scene. And they're so peaceful, completely happy with us being here. Not fazed with us at all. It's amazing to see how they suck the water up with their trunks and then lower that water into their mouth. Just like that. See? Lifting the trunk and drinking. So they don't really blow it out. All that happens is they rely on gravity and the water then flows out of the trunk into the mouth as they lift it up and they drink that way. They can take quite a lot of water into their trunks, about 8 to 10 liters. So Robin from Maryland has asked an interesting question about the elephant and what keeps the water from going all the way up through the nasal cavity when it goes up their trunk. So they have got valves and they do control it, and the trunk is made up of so many muscles, so they can control it very well. They won't suck it all the way up right into the nasal cavity, but what they'll do is they'll suck it up, hold it, and then as they release when they are lifting their trunk, they release it and it flows down into their mouth. But there are thousands of muscles within that trunk. It really is an incredible appendage. See these two still drinking intently. Incredible sound, very interesting vocalization came from that elephant. And that could have been for a number of reasons. Maybe it was just a little bit agitated with that adult behind it. It is in a tricky spot there at the moment, struggling to get out. It's amazing how elephants can climb there. And climb up really steep embankments and go down the most incredible places if they have to. Another beautiful female walking towards us. I hope you're all enjoying this as much as I am. Perfect for a Saturday afternoon. See, the herds like this of elephant predominantly consist of the females and a lot of the calves or the youngsters, but mainly females. There will be young males within this herd, but once they get to a certain age, like those first two that we saw earlier, they generally get pushed out of the herd. The reason for that is that the females just are a little bit hesitant with having those young bulls. They get a bit boisterous, they cause a bit of unrest within the herd. So they get pushed out, and then what happens is those males will go and try and meet up with big dominant bulls. And those bulls then teach those younger males how to be more successful, how to be dominant, and how to look for females when they are ready to mate. But for now, within a herd like this, it's mainly the youngsters with the adult females, but there will be some young males there too. So Christine has asked a question about the elephant, and Christine would like to know, do elephants use tools? So Christine, no, not that I have ever seen. They rely a lot on the strength of the power and the capability of that of the trunk. They can pick up tiny little fruit, or they can break big branches with it. The other two, I suppose you could call them tools, are their tusks. They rely a lot on that to tear bark, break branches, or dig up mud or sand. They do use their tusks quite a lot. And also their feet. They will kick loose a lot of trees or branches or roots that they are looking to feed on. They often kick up sand and mud so that they can throw it on their backs. The reason for that is it protects their skin, cools them down, and also keeps a lot of the flies away. In terms of using any other tools around, I've never seen it, and I don't think they do. But as I've listed, they've got a number of other tools that they can use. Timing was perfect. As we came around the corner, we could see these elephants in the water hole. And look how they've all started to move off. Really fantastic to see these elephants in the water hole, the interaction, the sounds. And while they move off, why don't we cross over to James and get an update from him? Maybe he has something regarding those lions.
All right, just a quick update from us, everybody. I eventually found one lion track coming north over the road, just into this area here. I'm probably going to go off on foot and just see if we can't find them. They may be down in the shade here in the drainage line. But while we do that, I think spend a little bit more time with Byron on Cheetah Plains. And then if I have any success, which I'm hopeful of now, we'll let you know.
Okay, so James is going to go and follow up on that track that he's found. We are still sitting with these elephant. And it's actually such a beautiful sighting. I don't think we're going to leave just yet. There's still at least three in the water, or three that we can see around the water hole. One or two feeding off to the side, and the rest of the herd has moved off slowly in a westerly direction from here. But they're in no rush to leave. It looks like these three are really enjoying what's left, or the last few sips of water before they decide to move on. Elephant really do love water. I've seen in different areas where the water is more prevalent, and especially up Botswana area where there's a lot of flooding and you've got large rivers, elephants will often go right into these rivers and swim. They play around, especially in the summer when it's very hot. They play and if they need to cross these deep rivers, they will swim right across them, where you just see the trunks sticking out of the water, breathing for them. It's incredible. So Katie from Kentucky has asked about those valves in the trunk and up closer to the nasal cavity, whether or not sand can clog up the trunks, or how, or do they use those same valves to stop it? They definitely use the same valves. Those trunks are incredible appendages for the elephant. I don't think we really understand the extent of how well they are able to be used. They definitely control everything that goes in and out, and I don't think they get blocked at all. I've never ever seen or heard of an elephant having a blocked trunk. Those valves would control that, all that sand that they pick up and suck up. Usually what they do though is they try and grab it with their trunk. They wrap the sand or the mud around the bottom of their trunk, almost like you would scoop it with your hand, and then they throw it on their backs. They don't necessarily suck up the sand or the mud, but there will definitely still be some dust that can get up into the trunk, but they will then eventually blow it out, just like you would blow your nose. They will get rid of it so it doesn't get blocked. But it is an incredible appendage, and it's amazing the ability to pick up tiny, tiny objects like fruit or little sticks, and the ability to break branches. The strength in that trunk is unbelievable. Quite a nice bit of interaction with these two in front of us, just playing, pushing, rubbing their trunks, and see that elephant on the left missing half of its tail there. We saw that this morning with the giraffe. A giraffe is also missing a bit of a tail. That can be for a number of reasons. I would think that this elephant is possibly missing its tail because it got an infection, maybe from ticks. And often what happens is that infection or those ticks can cause an animal to lose its tail. And with other animals, you might see a tail get bitten off, maybe from lions. I don't think this is from lions. I have seen up in Botswana and Zambia, where I was mentioning where the elephants cross the rivers, where crocodiles go and they try their luck, and they occasionally grab an elephant tail and bite it off. So that is also a cause, but that would not happen in this area. I don't think where we are now, there are some big rivers to the south, a lot of crocodiles there, but I don't think these elephants spent enough time in those rivers for crocodiles to bite the tails off. I think that is possibly from ticks. Well, there hasn't been too much mud splashing around with these elephant. The reason for that is because it is winter, so it's not too hot. But in summer, when it is very hot, they like to splash water and mud on their backs. Helps keep them cool. And often what they will do then is they'll go find a nice big tree and rub up against it. The reason for that is it scrapes off some of the ticks that might be sitting on them. Just get rid of the fleas that they have, but they've got very thick hides, so they don't have many, not like a lot of the antelope species in that, but the mud does help them. And you'll have these prominent rubbing posts. When they go in, they rub right up against it and it becomes very, very smooth. I'll try have a look while we are driving if we can find a rubbing post. I might see something up on that big tree just now if we drive past there. I don't want to move just yet. This is still so lovely and I don't want to disturb these two that are drinking. They've become completely relaxed with us. But the rest of the herd do seem to have moved off. Spraying the water. So Brock would like to know if elephants ever leave the national parks and cause damage to neighboring farms or neighboring areas. Brock, in certain areas it can occur. I mean, we are very far away from any settlement at the moment. But on the outskirts of the Greater Kruger National Park, yes, there are settlements and farms. And if the elephant do get out, they try their best to get them back as quickly as possible if they can. But they can cause damage. In other parts of Africa, elephant can be a problem for farmers. They destroy the produce and the lands that the farmers have. So it does happen. But again, we need to remember, you know, these animals were here first. We are taking over their land and their habitat. So we cannot complain. It's part of living close to nature. One just seems to be smelling it over there. So Helen has asked, what is an elephant's favorite food? So Helen, to keep these large animals going, they need to feed on a lot of vegetation. They are not too fussy. They will eat everything from grass to branches to leaves, bark of trees, roots and fruit. I must admit though, I think in summer, when these beautiful marula trees that we have in the area, when they give fruit or bear fruit, the elephant absolutely love that fruit. Very rich in vitamin C, but the flavor is very nice, and we can eat it too. And elephant will go and stand under marula trees. I've seen them rock a tree to shake some of the fruit out of the tree. It's incredible to watch. They lift their trunk up, and they place the bottom of their trunk or their mouth up against the tree, and they rock it once or twice, and that often shakes some of the fruit loose, and they will pick them up with their trunks and feed on it. You can find piles of elephant dung full of marula fruit. It's incredible to see. So I would say that's probably their favorite. So peaceful here at the moment. Few birds calling. I've heard a red-crested koran that's been calling quite a while. It's got a very interesting whistling sound in the area. I can't see it. It's a ground nesting bird and it's very difficult to spot, very well camouflaged. It sounds like a... If I hear it again, I'll try to point it out. I think it might be loud enough for you. Now this one's coming back to the water. So Nora has asked, do elephants hold their breath while they are drinking water? Or can they breathe through their mouth? They can definitely breathe through their mouth, Nora. So they don't have to hold their breath. They will just purely suck up the water. See, this elephant is very clever. Have a look there. So certain water holes in winter are pumped full of water. And the reason for that is it does get dry, and because of all the wildlife around, they do have to be managed. And that little pipe over there is pumping fresh water. When the water level drops, that pump will come on every now and then. It's probably solar powered, and that elephant knows exactly that is fresh borehole water. That's why it's sticking its trunk over there. But Nora, they will definitely not hold their breath. They will still breathe, but they will use their trunk just to suck up the water. And then as they are lowering it, just like we drink, then you obviously don't breathe, but they will then drink the water. Look at that, very interesting. Just incredible again. Look how that trunk works. Let's see if he puts it in his mouth. There we go. A little bit. I could sit here for hours watching these elephants. They, as I mentioned earlier, just one of my favorite animals. I think they're so intelligent and they can be peaceful and graceful and very caring animals to one another. I've often seen footage, and I've seen it myself, how they help the youngsters either get food or get out of water holes. You'll be surprised that a young elephant can often get stuck in a muddy wallow like this, and the adults will come and just give it a helping trunk and get out of the water. They are amazing animals. And then again, just their strength and power. I've seen an elephant push over a tree like it was nothing, a very large tree, a number of times. The reason they do that is purely to get to the leaves and the branches that are higher up if they can't reach it. It's an example of that elephant just blowing its trunk, and you saw the power of that air and the dust that was blown up from it. See, so it's very easy for them to keep the trunk clear. Have a look, see how that elephant's resting? Oh, it's picked up a little stick. Oh. Wow, look at this, very interesting behavior. See that trunk, it's got almost two muscles that act as a clamp, I suppose you could call it. And with that, it's able to pick up something as small as that little branch or leaves or branches. Incredible prehensile muscle, that trunk. And that whole trunk is basically one big muscle made up of many, many muscles. So Jenny from Texas has asked if once the grass becomes more scarce further into winter, will the animals move off? And yes, Jenny, they do. In certain times of year, when the vegetation decreases because of drought, animals do, we don't get migrations like you see in East Africa, but you will have seasonal movements within certain areas. They will try and go into areas where there might be better vegetation for them to feed on. So in an area like this where there's very little grass, you probably won't see too many zebra or wildebeest that specifically feed on the grass. They'll go and move into other areas, maybe clearings where there is grass for them to feed on. So you do get seasonal movements, but it won't be as large as a migration like you have in East Africa where they travel hundreds of kilometers to go into an area where there is food. We don't have that in Southern Africa. So the elephant seemed to have all moved off now. I think we are going to continue. And while we do that, why don't you go back to James and get an update from him and those lion tracks.
Now, I've done an extensive walk through this area, well, relatively extensive anyway. And, yeah, I don't know. I don't have any more tracks. I don't know where they've gone. There were some vehicle tracks coming in here. So maybe the very last people to view these lions came in here this morning. But I've had a walk through here. I haven't seen anything. We're going to do one last. We're just going to stick our noses in here along this old track. And if there's nothing here, you see there's some quite fresh vehicle tracks through here. So maybe she moved in here during the course of the day. But, you know, if she is the mother, and I've no reason to doubt she is, isn't, I've no reason to doubt that she is the mother. She could well have just headed straight back towards Torchwood. Because that's obviously what she needs to do. She needs to suckle her babies. So maybe it was just a brief hunting foray away. One or two more vehicle tracks through here. We'll just follow them through and then head out and see what else this marvelous wilderness has to offer us. Yeah. I think we's flogging a dead horse here.
So let's ease our way back out again and see what else we can see.
Very nice that you've had the elephants there, Torchwood, at least the cheetah plains. Marvelous animals, elephants, of course.
And especially when it's a little bit dry, they spend so much time drinking water and going down to water and then fighting with each other and playing. Ah, it's just great. This magnificent tree that we're driving underneath, of course, is called a torchwood. Can you reach a leaf there, Davy? There we go. Now, the torchwood leaf is quite leathery. It's not particularly tasty. And indeed, the fruit's oil, which is supposed to be flammable, but I've embarrassed myself on many occasions trying to light it for viewers and guests alike. I don't know, it seems to be inflammable when I try and light it. But it can be used to kill fish. And what the poison does is get into the gills of the fish and drops them dead. And apparently it doesn't taint the meat at all. So if you're ever desperate out here without a fish hook and really in need of something to eat and you're unable to get into the water to catch a catfish, that's your stuff. Torchwood seeds, crushed up, unburnt. I can see the lion track now. They're in here. Let's follow them. Now, Kevin in the Netherlands, you want to know what the most common bird we get out here is. Kevin, the most abundant bird that occurs in possibly here and in the world. Oh, colourful bird. Well, the most colourful bird we get out here is probably then the lilac-breasted roller. The lilac-breasted roller is got seven colours on it, male and female lilac-breasted roller. They, certainly at this time of the year, are by far the most colourful birds. At other times of the year, they are probably, the most colourful birds are probably the sunbirds. Well, in fact, I mean, they're around now as well, but you just don't see them very much because there are not many flowers for them to eat. Now, the tracks come through here. I'm in many minds as to what to do now. I mean, we're on the tracks. Well, let's have a listen and see if we can't hear some birds alarm calling. While we do that, Kevin, I'll show you a picture of these colourful birds. The sunbirds. Oh, you know what? The most colourful in summer are the bee eaters, I would say. So, if we go across to the sunbirds, there they are. And we get, the most colourful one we get here is called the collared sunbird. There. There. Isn't that beautiful? Stunning. Ooh, hang on. I'm getting an update in my ear about Karula. Oh, there's a kill. Let's go there. This is wonderful news, everybody. Okay, let's go back to Byron. I'm going to try and figure out what's going on here. Karula apparently not far from here. So let's go back to Byron, get an update from him. I'll keep up with you now.
That's exciting news that James has about Karula. Hopefully he has some luck there. Looks like the lions are evading him this afternoon. We're still just exploring Cheetah Plains. I have absolutely no idea where we are, so it's very fun. But I don't think we have gone off the beaten track too far. So I'm trying to look for some of the plains that they have in this area. And that'll be nice, I think, for some general game, which could be very interesting. Again, it's just so great to be able to drive through this area. Beautiful afternoon. So Aaron from New Zealand has asked, are there any areas outside of Africa that I'd like to visit to view wildlife? Definitely. Aaron, I think one thing I would really like to do, which is on my bucket list, is to go and look for snow leopards. up in Afghanistan, in the mountains, you get snow leopards. I'd love to be able to see snow leopards. What else? I mean, polar bears and wildlife in the Antarctic. That would be wonderful, something different. There's so much. Madagascar, South America, the Pantanal, jaguars. Oh, there's so many different places to go to. A beautiful area here, that beautiful clearing. Let's see what we have. Nice water hole. Let's see, there's a lot of buffalo dung around. Let me just stop and scan here a little bit. But look how beautiful and open this clearing is. Never know, you could find something laying in the shade of the trees just on the edge of these clearings. Often found predators, you know, during the day, especially in the morning, as it starts to warm up, they could possibly come and drink and then move off and look for a bit of shade. At the moment, I do not see anything, however. It seems very quiet here at the moment. But as I always say, it's too soon to panic. Let's continue. But it's nice to be able to be getting into these openings and these clearings. Generally, wildlife do enjoy this a lot. It's a bit safer for them. And the reason for that is just it's easier to spot any potential danger or predator that could be coming towards them. But during the day, even the antelope species and that will start moving off into the thickets and feeding, looking for a bit of shade. But in the evenings, I'm sure later this afternoon, early evening, I think you'll probably get quite a few animals coming out into these clearings and spend the night out here. It's far safer in the openings. This is interesting. Have a look at this tree in front of us. And unfortunately, it is dead. Now, this is an acacia tree, a knob thorn. But what has happened here, and if you look a little bit lower, look how pale that bark is. And the reason for that is elephant have ring barked this tree, which means they have stripped the bark right around the tree. What that causes is the tree, as you can see, to die. The reason for that is the bark contains a cambium layer, which is a layer which transports all the nutrients from the leaves to the tree and from the roots to the tree, back and forth. So with the elephant stripping the bark, and the reason they do that is to feed on it because it's got all the nutrients, and there's nothing to transfer those nutrients up and down the tree anymore. So that causes the tree to die. And how they do it, and we spoke about it earlier, is they use those tusks. And they're able to push a tusk into the side of the bark, and they pull it and they rip it open, and then they'll use their trunks and they'll strip it. And there's a tree like this, and you can actually see it up just to the top of the tree. You can see you have these strips of bark, and it's very easy for the elephant to strip the bark. There we go, see it hanging over there. And they pull these long strips of bark up the tree, and that's what causes it to move all the way up the tree, up to the top there, before it breaks off, and then they feed on it. So Don has asked the interesting question about when the elephant push over trees, and Don would like to know is, if those elephant push the trees over, do those trees continue to grow or do they die? So Don, what happens often is if the trees are pushed over but the root system is still intact and the tree hasn't broken completely, the tree is still able to grow. if the tree is pushed over and the root system is uprooted and broken, then that tree would not be able to grow anymore and inevitably dies. But either way, what happens is you do get a micro habitat forming. So you get a lot of other animals, scrub hares, little dakers, steenbok, often go and use those pushed over trees as shelters or as homes. And you get a lot of insects and birds nesting in there. So it's not always a bad thing. It does create another habitat for some of the smaller animals. See a few zebra tracks around here, and we are approaching another clearing. Oh, there's some beautiful clearings up ahead. Let's see, I'm sure we'll get some activity around there. Let's just keep scanning. Which way? Let's ask the viewers, should we go left or right? Who can give me an idea? Which way should we go? I have no idea. While I'm waiting for a left or right suggestion, I'm just scanning and seeing if I can't see anything. Oh, hang on. I've spotted a zebra. We are going right, everyone. While we're driving, I'm still just scanning back and forth, seeing if there's anything out on the other side of the clearing. I did see a zebra. So Lynn from Florida has asked what my favorite time of day is to do a game drive. Is it in the morning or is it in the afternoon? It's very difficult to answer, Lynn. I like both. There we go. Yeah, the zebra approaching just off to the left. And Lynn, I think... Let's see. Oh, I've seen two cheetah. Can you see the cheetah, everyone? Have a look there. Fantastic. They are heading in this direction. If we're lucky, they might cross over onto our side. That we are just on the boundary at the moment. And just south of us is an area known as Mala Mala. But those cheetahs are heading here. Let's sit tight. Wow, this is exciting. I'm just trying to watch. Let's just see. They're slowly moving in this direction. We'll wait and sit tight. So, Lynn, getting back to your question, morning or afternoon? It's hard to say. I mean, we had such a beautiful morning, and especially in winter, it warms up nicely, and it's a fantastic, fantastic time of the day. But the afternoon's also great, and the sunsets are beautiful. I don't know. It's hard to say. Right now, with cheetah approaching, I'd have to say the afternoon. I see two cheetah there moving through the thicket. They should break through that little scrub that they're in at the moment shortly, but there you can see them quite nicely. Wow, I haven't seen cheetah in the Sabi Sands for quite some time. I know these plains and these clearings are ideal for cheetah. And I'm not sure when last on Safari Live you saw cheetah. So this is fantastic. Like I say, they are heading straight towards us. So we are just going to sit tight here for a while. Hopefully we'll get a lovely view of them as they cross over. While they're walking, they'll most likely try and scent mark. Often what cheetah do is they find prominent trees, and that's what that one is doing there. Can you just see it's lifted its tail, scent marking? And the reason for that is this is obviously their territory, and while they're moving around, they constantly scent mark. I'm assuming these are two males. It does look like it. I'm just going to move up a little further forward while we wait for them. We might get a better view. They will also use these pushed over trees as a vantage point to have a look around and scan the clearings. And the reason for that is it just gives them a nice area, a nice little bit of a raised platform that they may scan and look around. So often cheetah, they don't climb as well as lion or leopard, especially not leopard, but they do jump into trees, and they will mainly, like I said, jump into trees. It's mainly trees that have been pushed over. They're a bit easier for them to climb into, and they'll stand on that and scan. And from that vantage point, they can have a look if there's any prey. Let's see. I don't see them now. Just trying to scan again. So I understand that everybody is as excited as I am about cheetah, because these are my first cheetahs for Safari Live. I know you have seen them a few times, and this is amazing. I'm very excited because I don't know this coalition. I'm assuming it is a male coalition from what I've seen already. I think they are. So we'll hopefully get them coming out. Don't see them at the moment, but I'm still scanning. But this is incredible. As I said, it's too soon to panic. You never know what you're going to bump into, and look at that. Two cheetah walking towards us. Let me just scan again quickly. Yeah, there, I see them. Yeah, VM has got them. That's great. They're moving further into the open, but still in our direction. Andrew or Mark, any station on this channel, do you copy me? Good afternoon, it's Byron here. Located the two male cheetah, the coalition. They are on the plains, and I think we're east of Hornbill Nest Road, and they are heading north. There are three MM vehicles here at the moment, but they are heading north. I'm just going to turn around quickly, everyone. This is very exciting. These cheetahs are heading straight towards us. So Safari Dude has asked, are these cheetahs heading towards the zebra? No, I don't think they are. A zebra is far too large for a cheetah to hunt. And I think the zebra would have got a fright because it's still a predator. And natural instinct will kick in, and the zebra will probably just move off, which is, I think, what happened there. But these cheetah will not be trying to hunt those zebra at all. They may go for a zebra foal, but it's unlikely and doesn't happen often. But if there's a zebra foal around, they could probably show some interest and try and hunt that. But in this situation, not at all. So while we're waiting for these cheetah to cross and trying to get into a better position, go across to James, get an update from him and see what he's up to.
Now, everybody, there's an elephant, and I must just congratulate you all, along with Beefy Byron, the buffalo hunter, for finding those cheetah. I think that's just too wonderful for words. His first trip down there, he's going to never want to leave. Now, we're sitting here in the Mulwati drainage line, the great raging torrent of water that flows through. There's an elephant there. We didn't come down here because of an elephant. We came here because we heard reports of Karula from here from this morning. Now, the reports that she had killed were incorrect. She has not killed, apparently. Well, she hadn't by this morning. And she was right over here. Now, I'm going to wait for this young bull to see what he does. I'm not sure. I don't think he'll sort of do us any damage. But he may come quite close, and let's see. We might be lucky there. But he's about to go past where the little drainage line that feeds, this tributary of the Great Mulwati, feeds in here, and that's where Karula was. He might find her for us, you know. I think this might be a photo opportunity, David. He certainly is coming quite close. Now, were he a great big 45-year-old elephant bull, I would be possibly in reverse already. He isn't. And so he's unlikely to do us too much harm, we hope. Like, he's too close for me to focus. This is fantastic, people. He's so close to us. What a beautiful fellow he is. Oh, this is wonderful. Don't fall. Don't slip. That's it. You're going to slip. Do you want me to move back, fellow? I can, if you want. This is fantastic. See, he's trying to get past us, but he doesn't want to slip now. And I don't want to really start the car because that's going to give him a fright. He's stepping over that bush. I'm not laughing at you. I'm sorry. You're being very, very kind to go around us like that. Thank you. That is too wonderful. Very loud. It is quite scary, I'm not going to lie, everybody. My heart rate is up. Dave, how are you feeling? Now he's throwing bushes at us. He's very cross that we made him step over that gardenia, which he probably pushed over. This is too fantastic. Now, like I say, I wouldn't be doing this with a 45-year-old elephant bull with great big tusks. He's about a 20-year-old, maybe 22 or 23. And he's just not quite confident enough to kind of say to us, get out of my way or you're going to be in trouble. That is just brilliant. Isn't that wonderful? Ah, what a very, very special sighting that was. Let's head back to the cheetah and Byron. We'll continue looking for the leopard over here.
That's a close call for James and that elephant. That is exciting. These cheetah have come right out into the open and are heading straight towards us. Look again, some scent marking. What a beautiful, beautiful sighting. They're out in the open. This is a fantastic, fantastic sighting. I brought my camera with me this afternoon. James recommended it. He said, you never know what you're going to see. And look at this. Just absolutely perfect. Wonderful light. So those of you who are photographers, if you would like to ask any questions about camera work, please don't hesitate. I'm going to take one or two snaps of this cheetah. Oh, just wonderful to see them moving across the clearing. This is typical cheetah terrain. Perfect for them to hunt if they do see anything. I was hoping they would head into that direction of the water holes that we passed. So Michael, who's aged 13, has asked an interesting question about the cheetah. We know that the cheetah is the fastest land mammal, and they can reach a speed of up to about 110, 120 kilometers an hour. Now Michael has asked, what is the stride length if a cheetah is in full, or is at full pace, full speed? That is difficult. I'm trying to think now, full stride length of a cheetah. I think it's close to around 4 or 5 meters, a stride length when they're at 110 kilometers an hour, very easily. You can see their whole body contorts when they are running. Their back, their spine is very, 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 bendy. it's supple. Their back is very supple, and that spine can bend very, very easily, and they can stretch. And what they do is the whole body opens and stretches as they stride, and they reach those top speeds. Cheetah's found a little bit of shade there, just lying down. See, they're still very, very clever. Even though they move around more during the day than any other predator, more than leopard and lion, definitely, cheetah do prefer hunting in the afternoon or early morning, especially the morning or late morning, and are more active during the day. They are not as active at night, and probably wouldn't hunt as much as at night. It does depend on the area though, but you know, they are still clever. They will still find shade, and they will still rest during the day. Isn't that beautiful? So Pamela has asked a question regarding the scent marking of the big cats. Now, Pamela would like to know, would big cats scent mark over each other? Now that is quite interesting, Pamela. I've seen big cats pick up on the scent of other big cats, lion, leopard, cheetah. Often they may use a similar tree, and the reason for that is because it's a prominent post. It is something that is passed through regularly by these animals in an area that they know very well in their territory. I don't think it's a case of them scent marking over the other one. The scent marking is purely to allow other predators of the same species that this is their territory. So other lions or other leopard or other cheetah. It's not a case of lions scent marking over cheetah because they want to chase the cheetah out, but they do definitely pick up on the scent of those other animals in the area. The scent marking is purely territorial for each species. Excuse me a second. Interesting that the one cheetah has decided to lie in the shade and the other one out in the open. Michael or Lex come back for Byron? Wrong radio. Michael or Lex come back for Byron? Mike or Lex, do you copy? Mike, sorry about that. Just an update. Still three WM vehicles here. They are still just south of the boundary. We are standing by. I'll let you know as soon as they cross. Copy, will do. So, is it another interesting thing is the multitasking that I spoke to you about, the me trying to work all the radios. So we're quite far from the FC at the moment, so I'm struggling to hear some of the questions coming through from Lou. But I think Lou has just asked a question about how often the cheetah need to drink. From Maggie in Australia. And Maggie, the cheetah, like most big cats, generally they will try and drink each day. You know, if the water is available and is around, they will definitely drink each day. But in some situations, if they are unable to, then maybe every second day, but they will still try to get to water. The thing with the predators is they do get a lot of moisture from their kills if they are able to still hunt. And if they are able to kill an impala, for example, they do get a lot of moisture from that, but they do still need water occasionally. As I said, it depends on the time of the year. In summer, when there's lots of rainfall, lots of water around, they will definitely go and drink daily. Go ahead. Okay, copy that. So Brock has asked a question about the cheetah and their hunting and their hunting style. Brock would like to know, do the cheetah hunt in a group or do they hunt solitary? So generally cheetah are solitary cats, not like lions who will hunt in a pride. However, you do get what we can see here, a coalition of males. So 1, 2, 3 or sometimes 4 males together. That form a coalition, and often because they're born into the same litter, and they will then stay together. The females generally stick to themselves and stay solitary, so they will definitely have to hunt for themselves. With the males, I don't think it's cooperative hunting like lions, but the cheetah will chase something together, and if one manages to separate an impala, for example, if they were chasing impala, separate an impala from the herd and pull it down, the other one probably wouldn't be too far behind to help either kill it or just start feeding on it very quickly. So they don't necessarily, I've never seen them chase an antelope or anything into one another. So one will wait in ambush, another one will chase something towards it. But that's not to say that it could never happen. You know, one thing I've learnt with being in the bush is that you can never, never guarantee anything. Animals adapt and they they always change their behavior depending on where they are in their surroundings and what works for them. But you know, these situations with these cheetah in this area and from these Sabi sands, greater Kruger that I've seen in the past, cheetah will hunt solitary by themselves. But if they are in a coalition, then the other one will definitely come and feed with the one who made the kill. But remember, with the females, they are solitary, so they do have to hunt for themselves. So Sharon from Tennessee has just asked if these two cheetah are related. Yes, Sharon, they most likely are. And the reason I say that is it's quite unlikely that two males from a different area will form a coalition. I have heard of it happening, and it can happen with lions. Lion coalitions, they can have males forming coalitions that are from different prides. In this situation, I think these two cheetah are most likely brothers. And that is generally the case. If one of them die, the other one will just continue on living. It will not go and look for another cheetah and join, especially not at this age. I think it is highly unlikely. But again, it's never a guarantee. That is just what we have seen, what we have read, research that has been done. I don't think they would, but you never know. They could possibly, but I don't think the one would actively go and look for another male to join and form a coalition. Generally with cheetah, they are brothers or related. So while these cheetah are lying down, let's go across to James, get an update and see what he is up to.
James, too, is about to lie down in frustration. I've done a walk through the area where Karula was seen this morning. I found not evidence of one track. We're now on our own out here because everyone is running for the cheetah as fast as they can. Anyway, we're going to keep looking around here. I think it'd be quite nice to see the queen. We haven't seen her for a little while. There were some guinea fowl there. They're now out of sight. Let's move a little bit further along. We might be able to get a view of the guinea fowl. At least I can show you something. There they are. You see them, David? Now, everybody, with this camera, you'll be able to make out two or three very small grey things moving away from us. There they are, guinea fowl. Hooray! Oh, very exciting, and we're about to get a real treat now. Keep watching. There we are. Wasn't that special, David? Very nice. Nissan pickup. Superb. A real classic. Let's carry on. There were some impala running around. There were also some waterbuck running around. Why they were running, we're not sure. So we're just going to keep fossicking around here and see if Karula hasn't come into the area. She certainly apparently was stalking some impala today. So maybe she's killed. Maybe she's gone back to fetch the cubs. Maybe she has not killed and has gone away again for a long time. But let's go around the corner and have a look-see. Plenty, plenty of impala tracks, and I think they've been running all over the place, and they've probably obliterated any leopard tracks that there have been around here during the course of the day. So that was Twin Dams we were on there. Twin Dams Dam, which consists of one dam, not two. Don't know why it's called Twin Dams. Karula might pop out onto the road as it gets a little cooler, and it's certainly starting to do that already. Let's ease our way down this way. Now, Well, now that's interesting, Tasha. You say, how far will lions move after eating? Well, normally not at all. Normally they'll lie down precisely where they finish their meal. They often don't even move to go and relieve themselves. And so I'm quite surprised, actually, that they weren't there. In fact, I'm really surprised. But for the wonderful update we had of them, the fact that one of them is a mother. So she could well have headed off back towards Torchwood. I don't know where her companion would have gone, but normally they'd stay exactly where they were, or you'd expect to find them sort of lazing about the water. Hasn't been very hot, so I don't know. I'm most confused by the whole situation. Unless one of the others is pregnant and they've used that sort of drainage line system there to go and sort of rest up in. Because they will start to seek out cover much more than they will normally if they're pregnant. Now this is where Johan Danhauser from Biffle's Hook saw Karula this morning, somewhere around this area. And I was walking down all through there. I saw no evidence of her. There is a bird, a persistently calling grey go-away bird going, wah, 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 indicating displeasure. Why it should be feeling displeasure? Well, that's anyone's guess. Now, it sounds like there are quite a few people trying to get into that cheetah sighting, so I'm not sure how long Byron's going to be able to be there. But just wonderful that we've had the time with him. I'm going to say we because I feel so part of it. Otherwise, I'll just be very jealous. Just drive in here. There's a little link road that goes to the top of the drainage line. Let's see if there's anything along here. Well, there's a Franklin eating some elephant dung. That's exciting. Oh, there's a bouncing stick. Oh, Karula, why dost thou do this to me? Hello, Julia. What a lovely question from you about dispersal males. Please excuse my not looking you in the eye while I answer. I'm just trying to keep an eye out for possible leopards, you know. Julia, you want to know how they know when to start scent marking. It's just the onset of hormones, you know. It's puberty. So when Sindelia goes into puberty and he, you know, comes to a certain age, achieves a certain size, his body will produce a certain suite of hormones that will in turn allow him to start scent marking. Same with a lion. So they start exactly as the same. So, I mean, the best way to describe it, I suppose, would be to compare it with a male human being. You know how when a male human being turns 18 or so, somewhere around there, he starts to assert himself physically. He tests himself first when he's 16 or 17 years old, normally gets the stuffing knocked out of him once or twice, and then once he's big and strong, then he starts to assert his dominance. And that is precisely how it would work with a leopard or a lion. They'll sort of start tentatively marking territory, then they'll start to call, and then they'll probably get the stuffing knocked out of them once or twice by the dominant male leopard, or certainly be given a fright by him, and then they'll back off, and eventually they achieve the right sort of size at age 5, and they achieve the right sort of level of maturity. And then it's, you know, they'll try and take a territory. That's how it works. This is where she was seen this morning. Like I say, it wasn't a very hot day, so I suspect if she didn't kill something here, she's probably pressed on elsewhere. That doesn't mean we're going to stop looking for everybody. Fear not. Well, I have to find something today other than one guinea fowl running away. Sorry, Davy, I'm going to really create consternation for you there if I try and turn around. So I walked up, down, through here. Nothing.
Nothing's alarm calling. Everything is at complete peace. Right, maybe we'll be lucky. My luck has not been with us the last few drives. That elephant was too spectacular. I still can't believe it. I think he nearly slipped onto us there and got himself into a bit of a pickle when he realized he was going to either have to come within sort of 2 feet of us, or he was going to have to climb over that. He's going to have to climb over that worry, that gardenia bush. He's very disconcerted by that. All right, Byron has found more heartbeats. Let's go and have a look at them.
We have just left those two cheetah. They were still lying down and resting. I think they may get up and move a little bit later. We decided that we would give some of the other people in the area a chance to go and have a look at them. We had such a lovely sighting of them out in the open. But we've come up to a clearing directly north. Just and you will see it on buffalo and other animals like rhino. You see the oxpeck is sitting and often picking at open wounds. And the reason for that, again, is they want the blood. So that actually causes the wounds to stay open a little bit longer. But in this case, they're purely sitting on these impala to clean them and preen them and get rid of the ticks and the fleas that are sitting on them. Really is a lovely afternoon, and they're beautiful views from these plains. All around us, nice open clearings. So Naomi from Pretoria has asked a question about bushwalks, and is there any specific color or clothing color of clothing that you should wear when on a bushwalk? So Naomi, generally on bushwalks, it is preferred if you wear neutral colors, so like dark greens, that khaki color, the browns, something like that, that kind of blends into the bush a little bit better. But it's not too strict, and it's not such a bad thing if you wear anything else. Ideally, you don't want to wear completely black or white, because that can stand out actually a lot more than colors like what I've got on now. So generally speaking, on a bushwalk, you'd want something around this color, or khaki color, brown color. Most importantly is, as long as you've got comfortable shoes, that is very important on a bushwalk. Comfortable shoes, water, hat, sunscreen, and then clothing that you will be comfortable in to walk for long periods of time. But color, I would try and stick to neutral colors, especially on a bushwalk. On a vehicle, it's not as bad. You can basically wear anything. Why don't we carry on? I'm trying to head back towards a waterhole and see if we have anything coming down to drink. Naomi, I'm not sure if it is you that made the comment this morning about me indicating while I was on drive. We all had a very good laugh about that when we got back to camp. My hand going to the indicator is pure, instinct, just a natural reaction. You get so used to it when you're driving around the cities or at home. And even out here, my hand went and I thought, hang on, I don't have to indicate for anything. But we had a really good laugh about that. So nice to have this beautiful light now. I'm sure some of the other guests, I saw some photographers on the other vehicles that were heading towards the cheetah. It's perfect light for photography if you've got keen photographers with you, or if you are a keen photographer. This hour, we often refer to it as the golden hour. It's just beautiful light, and it's great for natural lighting for photography, and especially for big cats. A lot of elephant dung in these areas. This is all old elephant dung, but I've definitely been moving through here, and that herd that we saw this earlier this afternoon, probably one of the herds that frequent this area. Scanning through these clearings as we are driving. So Tasha has asked an interesting question about the impala that we saw further back. Tasha would like to know why on their rump they have got those black coloration markings, or the black marking around the rump. And Tasha, that's a very good question. Now the reason or the theory behind it, and I always say theory is because a lot of research has been done, but occasionally we're not 100% sure. I mean, this scientists have done studies on it, and you know, most of the wildlife knowledge that we have we get from books, and I'm almost certain that it is true, but I don't think that we are always 100% certain with our theories. Again, this is the most plausible, but the one is that those black markings around the rump attract the ticks and the fleas and that to that area. It's a bit darker, it's a bit warmer, so that attracts the fleas, and it is easier for the impala to turn around and groom themselves and get rid of those, and preen themselves, get rid of the, get rid of the ticks and the fleas. It's easier to reach with their teeth. So that is why that black marking is around the rump. It's a little bit on the edge of the rump, so they can reach there if they need to. Don't have anything at the waterhole at the moment. So nice and still. Scanning around. Some more zebra tracks around here. I think these zebras will come down and drink during the day, disappear into the thickets quite easily, and with their camouflage, especially this time of year, they can disappear very easily. While we are driving around and heading to the next clearing or next area, let's head back to James and see if he finally has got any updates for us about Karula or lions.
No, I've got nothing to tell you at all, everybody, I'm afraid. Sometimes the drainage line here, and then we're going to head west, and I do believe that there's a lion at the Arethusa Dam, so if you want to see it, have a look on the Arethusa Dam cam. We probably will head across there, actually. I wasn't going to, but we've got quite a lot of time left, and my own tracking skills seem to have deserted me entirely. So let's head across there, maybe. It will take a little while to get there, so we're just going to do a last pass through here. And we'll go and look at a lion that a viewer found us from somewhere overseas. Well done. Better than I've achieved today. I don't think she's in here. Well, she could really be. I mean, a leopard can hide from you at 2 feet quite easily. Very pretty sun going down in front of us. It's not going to be a blindingly red or orange sunset because we've had so little cloud today. And I think we're in for another cold night. I've already put my jacket on. The got his jacket on as well. There's a lovely smell in here that comes up. Yes. There we go. Mulwati drainage line.
Hi Alex, afternoon everybody. How are you? How are you? And hi again. So James still hasn't got any updates for you. That's very unfortunate. But I hear he is heading to a lion. So while he does that, while he's driving off to Arethusa, hopefully he has further luck. We haven't had any further luck yet. We just passed a vehicle full of guests and they are also heading off to go and view their cheetah. And it's very exciting when something like a cheetah is seen, because it's not seen very often in these areas. You know, it is quite thick, especially this part of the Greater Kruger. You don't get a lot of cheetah activity. It's always fantastic and exciting to see them. So everyone in the area is hopefully going to get a good view. And again, I'm just really bumbling around here, not really sure which roads I'm on. Or as far as I know, we are still on cheetah plains. And but it's so exciting just to be able to drive and not really know where we are. And I don't know what's around the next corner. So I'm very much like you back home at the moment. I'm not sure what's going to come up or where we are going, but I'm just driving the vehicle. See quite a few more elephant tracks along the road. It's quite nice with the sun, even though it's difficult to drive into the sunset, and it's usually not ideal for when you do have guests, but occasionally it is unavoidable. But what happens is the sun shining off the road does shine onto the tracks, and it becomes quite easier to see them. And I can just see the shine or the sheen of those elephant tracks coming off the sand. So Fox Hat from Surrey would like to know how far elephant can travel in a year. So Fox Hat, it's a difficult question to answer, and I'll tell you why. It all depends on the area, it depends where they are. Also asked if they migrate. So in Southern Africa we don't have migrations like you see in East Africa. However, you will get seasonal movements depending on where food and water is available. And in East Africa they do migrate, because the water in those areas will disappear completely, and those elephants will have to move and go and look for fresh water and fresh food in other areas. So they do migrate. Here they can cover huge distances. They're not territorial, so they will cover a distance, especially in winter if they need to go look for more food or more water. They can head out of an area completely, and here they could move from here all the way into the Kruger National Park directly east of us, and they can cover huge distances, but they don't migrate like they do in East Africa, not down here. Is that a lapwing? No. Just trying to see if I can show you an interesting bird here quickly. Got the Cape turtle dove, or the ring-necked dove, over there. And then I heard some lapwings. Just trying to see where they are now. They are calling, but I do not see them. Have you got them? Look at that VM. Where are they gone now? There they go. There we go. Look at that VM, thank you. That is a blacksmith lapwing. And it's a beautiful black and white bird. Why I stopped to show you that is they are incredible little birds. They are ground nesting. And what happens is often you have these large animals, and the blacksmith lapwings, sorry, are usually around water holes like this. But you can imagine being around a water hole. You have a lot of animals coming down to drink, especially the larger animals like the elephant. And this is the water hole we saw the elephant at earlier, or buffalo. A lot of those big animals moving through. You can imagine as a ground nesting bird, that's quite frightening, because you could have your nest stood on or definitely disturbed by these large animals moving through. So these birds, what they do is they lay very well camouflaged eggs on the ground. But another thing they do, and I've seen it a number of times, if a big elephant or buffalo walk too close to the nest, these birds start mobbing them. They fly around and they come down and they dive bomb these huge animals and they chase them away. It's incredible to see. I've seen a lapwing on the ground. So we get the blacksmith lapwing and the crowned lapwing, which are quite common in this area. But I've seen a blacksmith lapwing standing on the ground with its wings open, chirping, and a buffalo walking up to it and it pecking the buffalo on the nose and chasing the buffalo away from its nest. Incredible to see. Well, we're going to drive around a little bit further and see if we don't have any more luck with some other animals. While we do that, let's cross over to James and see if he's got that lion at Arethusa.
He's not on Arethusa, everybody, but he has found a heartbeat. Now, that is a remarkable achievement for me today. There is a kudu, albeit only two-thirds of a kudu, the rest of him hiding behind a bush. Now, there are two kudu, in fact, there are a few of them in here, and a warthog. David, there's a warthog running through the bush there, terrifying the wits out of the kudu. Stop dead, you can see. Very nice picture there of the back end and the front end. Here come the kudu out into the open, magnificent spiral-horned antelope, the largest that we get here. I think they're rather splendid. And I always thought one of the most interesting things about kudu is that the males apparently live only half the length of time that the females do. And that's because they fight so much over ladies. Now, the females can live for up to 14 years. The males, normally not longer than 7. And that's because they do fight, and also because of those big horns of theirs. Now, can you imagine? They're browsers, of course, so they live in thick bush. Can you imagine trying to get away from a lion chasing you through thick bush if you had horns like that? Almost impossible. So what they have to do is they run with their horns flat back against the back of their necks, and it means that they can't really see where they're going, which again I think is quite amusing. So they do get taken out quite a lot. That's so the theory goes. When I think practically though of how many kudu I've seen being eaten by lions, I have to say it's not that many. Oh, Davy, if you just go, can you see the female there to the left-hand side? No, the left of that. There we are. She's looking very intently into the bush there, and she has been for the last little while. Now, if there was something there, she would alarm call, and it goes, oh, it's like a sort of oh, hoarse bark. But she's not doing that. Right, Brian's got some elephants. Apparently he'd like to show them to you immediately.
So, James had a heartbeat, and I've got something with a much larger heartbeat. Look at this beautiful elephant bull. Nice big old bull. Just so graceful. There is a herd further down in the distance, further along the road. But this guy is magnificent. Look at that elephant swagger walking across. Not a worry in the world. He was very calm. Not worried about us. Oh, magnificent. Got very thick tusks. I did see a tip of his tusk had been broken off. And that often happens with elephant. So Gracie, aged 8, has sent us such a wonderful comment. She has said she loves elephant because the elephant always make her feel better and make her tummy feel good. Gracie, I agree. They make me happy too. I love elephant. I'm glad you do too. And I hope you get an opportunity to see elephant in real life sometime soon again. Look at him wandering off. That is fantastic. What I'm going to do is just drive further down the road quickly. Let's go see what the rest of those elephants are doing and if it is in fact a whole herd down there. Viam and I have been very lucky this afternoon. We have been seeing quite a lot. How's that for a first trip to Cheetah Plains? I must admit, I need to give James a bit of credit. He did recommend it. Again, the signal's a little bit tricky where we are at the moment. Viam, did you hear that last question? Do elephants sing? Do elephants sing? And that was from Christine. Christine, I've never heard an elephant sing. I'm just trying to see. Can you see there? The light is a little bit tricky at the moment for you. We are looking directly into the sunlight. These just look like two younger elephants. Let me see if I go a little bit further back, maybe. Let's hold it there, Viam. Let's see. A little bit better. There we go. So, Christine, no, I don't think elephants sing at all. They do vocalize, and they do, and they can trumpet and make a very loud sound, but I don't think it's singing. Look at them feeding. They're using those trunks again. These trunks are used for absolutely everything. Again, we've hit almost that still part of the afternoon like we did yesterday. It's become a little bit quieter, not as many birds calling. But I think as the sun starts going down further, we will get those last afternoon or early evening calls from all the birds. And the bush seems to come to life again before they all go to sleep. And then hopefully we'll start hearing something out of their head. And if I can please explain it to her. So Kathy, that gland is known as the temporal gland up on the side of the head. Now that gland, basically what it does is it secretes a lot of the excess hormones and testosterone, especially in the bulls. You do see females doing it too, and that it's all signs that that the hormones or the testosterone within these elephant is at a higher level, and they start secreting from that gland. The bulls, when they are in a stage known as must, which is spelt M-U-S-T-H, and it's apparently an Indian word. Must is the stage that the elephant bulls go into when they are looking to mate. So that is when they can be slightly temperamental. Their hormone levels are off the charts. A lot of testosterone. They're looking for the females and hoping to mate with them. And then they sweat profusely from the temporal glands, and also they secrete liquid from the penis, and you can see it running down the legs often, and they get a very pungent smell, very strong pungent smell. You can smell immediately if an elephant is in must, and generally you try and give them a wide berth. Beautiful sunset too. This is really great. So nice to spend some time with elephant again. I think we're going to leave them now, let them carry on with their business of feeding. They'll constantly feed throughout the evening. They may stop and rest for periods of time, but they still need to feed constantly. Elephant definitely need a lot of food to keep those big bodies going. Let's continue. I just got an update about those cheetah. They have not moved at all. They're still lying out in the open. But we are being very kind this afternoon. We had a wonderful view of them, and we're giving some of the other people a chance to view them. Some of the guests in the area from the lodges around here. And I am now going to attempt to find my way back to Juma. I think it's that way. You never know what else we could bump into though. We've been very fortunate this afternoon. Saw some zebra earlier. That herd of elephant drinking was fantastic. Lovely interaction. And to see them just in and around a waterhole is incredible. So while VM and I start making our way back towards Juma, cross over to James and see if he has got any more updates for you.
Teeming herds, everybody. Teeming herds of dressage ponies with pajamas on, going running across the road. Here we go. Sorry to terrify you, young zebra. We've come on to Arethusa. I've heard no updates about the male lion at the Arethusa Dam cam, so we're just going to pull in there and see what we can find. Nobody wishes to talk with me on the radio. I think they're all sort of further north. Let's go a little bit further forward. There's another one on our left here. Twitching to get rid of the flies. You'll find many animals out here twitching away their skins, their ears, they're flicking their tails, trying to get rid of the flies, the endless flies. And you know, this year, while we watch exactly the reason why zebras are striped, you can see them moving through the woodland here, and the dimming light makes it very clear why they are stripy, I think. It has been astounding to me this winter how many mosquitoes have managed to somehow survive. It might just be in my particular room, but despite the cold, when I turn the light out at night, the over and abiding sound that I hear, other than the snoring of my very close neighbours, is that of mosquitoes. And it's very unusual.
that zebra is way too old to be suckling. And apparently Chelsea in the final control, who is one of my neighbours, says she doesn't snore. Now, of course, I've never met anyone in the world who's ever admitted to snoring before. This is because you cannot hear yourself snore when you are asleep. Not so, David.
Indeed.
Ergo, it is impossible to say whether you snore or not. I remember once, I'm fairly convinced that I do snore, but I remember once hearing my brother snore when we were very little and we shared a room, and I said, "Douglas, you snore." He said, "I don't. It's impossible." I said, "Well, how do you know?" He said, "I just know." That is a very large zebra to be suckling. I'm just going to quickly talk on the radio. No, we didn't, I'm afraid. I did check that area extensively. I gave it a good walk around, didn't find even a track, so I'm afraid not, chaps. I've left that area now. I'm just telling them about Karula. So, we've also got some impala wandering through the woodland here, and the sound of them wandering through the woodland at this time of the year, completely different from the summertime. And we'll just give it a listen for a few moments. Isn't that nice? That's the sound, of course, of dry leaves. And that's a great advantage to these herbivores because it makes it that much more difficult for the carnivores and predators to walk through this area without breaking a leaf. And the hearing is so acute in the impala and the zebra, and it's no accident that they're standing so close to each other. They will be using each other for security. And their hearing is so acute that were a leopard to be stalking one of them and standing on a cracked leaf or something like that, what they would do is unquestionably look that way and they would be alerted. Jacob, you're in London. When my sister's in London, she says it's quite sunny there. I don't know if you're a remainer or a departer, but that will depend on your mood, I suppose, today. But you're on safari in Africa this evening. And you want to know why there are so many impala. The answer to that is a simple one, believe it or not. There are many answers out here that aren't simple. That one is simple. There are so many impala because there is so much water around. Now, I know it looks like there's a drought, and there is a drought, but throughout the Kruger National Park, and especially in the Sabi Sands, all the landowners pump water, which means that you can actually not go more than 2 or 3 kilometers in any one direction and not hit water at some stage. Pieces of land here are pretty small, and that means that everybody's got water on his land, and impala are tremendous grazing and browsing competitors if they can get enough water. In the Kruger Park they can get absolutely enough water, and so there are just great swathes of impala where there used to be eland and sable and sometimes even roan. But because of the water, the impala and the zebra have outcompeted most of the other grazers, and that's why they're so much more rare. And you know, in the Sabi Sands in the early 60s, before the advent of artificial waterholes in this area, they used to shoot sable antelope for rations. So that's how numerous they were. They were considered something of a pest. Then the water came, and then the impala took over. They're also, I mean, they are a highly successful species anyway, and that's because they browse and they graze. They've got this astoundingly well-timed lambing season where they all lamb down within sort of 2 weeks of each other in November, which is an amazing skill that they have, amazing ability, and that does certainly contribute to their numerousness. Numerousness, David? What is the noun I'm looking for there? Their numerous nature, their numerosity, their numerity.
Abundance.
Abundance, much better word, thank you. We'll go with abundance, as opposed to numerosity, which unquestionably is not a word.
try and get you a picture of what actually is a very red sun indeed. Oh, it's going to go down. Davy, there's a quick look at it, and then we'll drive a quickly fast to the driveway and see. That's your hand. There we are. See how red it is. Quite quickly fast to the driveway, and you'll see we can't get a better view of it going down. Hold on, here we go. That clicking that you can see on the picture, everybody, is something called, if I'm not mistaken, David, an ND filter. Now, what that does, of course, is just filter the light. And while it may seem like David is just pointing the camera and pressing go, there are enormous numbers of adjustments that he's making all the time. And one of those, of course, is for the light. So if you stare straight at a piece of light, well, then you have to change all sorts of settings. There is a kudu there. I'm just going to try and get onto the airstrip and see if we can't see the last embers of the sun going down. But I fear me we might be a little bit late. Yes, I think we are. Anyway, we might be lucky at the very end. There's a nice high point at the northern end of the Arethusa airstrip, which is just down here. I haven't heard any further updates on that lion, so I don't know if he's still there, but we'll go and look. With my luck today, he will have absconded about 2 minutes ago. He certainly will begin absconding somewhere fairly soon as the darkness starts to fall. And now I'm just going to assume that he's a Birmingham boy. Three of the Birminghams apparently are on Biffle's Hook at the moment, and they've been feeding with three lionesses, supposedly of something called the Torchwood Pride. Now, I am a little skeptical of the Torchwood Pride's existence, to be honest, given that we never hear about them. And I suspect there was somebody asking today, where are the Shimungwe Pride? I wonder if they aren't members of the old Shimungwe Pride. But who knows? Lex and I were discussing it over a split pole fence today. He was in Gallagher camp and I was in the storeroom, and he, which is utterly irrelevant to any story, but he didn't know who those lions were either. It's strange, the details one chooses to share every so often. Right, we're nearly onto the airstrip here. Let's see what's going on there. It's getting quite nippy, isn't it, Dave? Now, David, of course, is a little bit under the weather. He's got a little cold in his nose and all over his body, I suspect. I said to him, have you taken anything for this? And he said to me, yes, I've dosed up a bit. He then gave me a list of the things that he's taken. I'm surprised he's still standing, actually. I think he was taken enough to knock out a small elephant. Apparently, Byron has something to show you. Let's go across and see him.
Enough about James's medication. Look at this. This is my favorite bird, a beautiful martial eagle. Wow, he is gorgeous. Look at that. Beautiful yellow eyes. See that little crest on the back of his head? Very large head. Strong, powerful beak, and look at those talons, a little bit lower down, look, perched beautifully on that branch. This is one of the largest eagles we have in the area. It is, actually, now that I think about it, this is the largest eagle we have in this area, the martial eagle. Very big, powerful eagle. And they will prey on something very interesting. Now we get monitor lizards, very large lizard species in this area. We have rock monitors and the water monitors. And these martial eagles prey on those monitor lizards. They specialize in hunting them. Then the reason why I find it so fascinating is because those, look how that head bends, look at that, the neck. Their eyesight is incredible. It must have spotted something. But anyway, getting back to the monitor lizards, why I think it is so fascinating is because these monitor lizards are so powerful and very thick-skinned, and they're large lizards. They're not small at all. Very sharp claws, and these martial eagles are able to hunt them very easily. This is a great sighting. Wow, this is beautiful. They will also hunt other birds that they will, perhaps something like a guinea fowl or Franklin, that they can try and ambush and fly down and catch. But very expert hunters. So, Gerda has asked a question about the dry conditions we are experiencing at the moment. I wouldn't say it's quite a drought yet, Gerda. And Gerda would like to know, do we see a change in the number of bird species and birds that we see when it is so dry? Well, Gerda, in winter, we definitely see less birds because a lot of bird species migrate north for the summer. And so that will definitely cause the bird species and the number of birds to decrease. But the bird life generally, from what I have seen, does remain the same. Look at him perch right up on the top of that tree. But the bird life generally in these areas, there is still a little bit of water around, and there will still be food for them. So the bird numbers, from what I have noticed, even in dry conditions, you still see a lot of birds around. But the number in winter and in the dry season does decrease from summer because you have a lot more migrants which come down for the summer. It's amazing. These large martial eagles can even hunt small antelope, like a young impala, or even Steenbok. So Amy, all the way from the United States, has asked if this eagle is as powerful as the bald eagle. Oh, look, there he goes. And off he goes, look at that. This eagle is definitely as powerful as the bald eagle which you get in the United States. It could even be more powerful. It is an incredibly powerful eagle, that martial eagle. So graceful, and I'm so happy I got to show you it. As I said, it's my favorite bird by far. Just the deep set eyes and that look on its face, it just looks like it means business. It's a very serious bird, but so, so beautiful. Wow, that was a treat. That was really, really great. We are on our way back towards Juma, just on the main access road at the moment. We've left Cheetah Plains, and we'll see what else we can find along the way. Let me stick some lights on here. While we are heading back towards Juma, I hope James has taken some of the medication so that he's not too grumpy when he gets back to the camp. Why don't you go have a look if he has an update for us?
Vine, so funny. There's a hippopotamus over there. We've come to the Arethusa Dam, everybody. And the reason we came to the Arethusa Dam is because apparently there was a lion seen here on the Arethusa Dam cam. Now, that lion is either invisible to the naked eye and only visible through the dam cam, or he has walked off. And given the temperature, I suspect strongly that he's walked off. So if anybody did see him walk off, it would be most kind of you to tell me where he walked off to. That hippopotamus, of course, not alone. He has some friends you can see all around him in the form of about 7 million catfish that are forming a sort of bed for him, flapping about the place. Some of them will survive, of course, when it dries out. They'll go under the mud. They exude some sort of a slimy gel
in which they stay relatively moist. I don't see any lion tracks on the road, but I mean, given my tracking skills today, it wouldn't surprise me if we'd driven over him. So if you do know where he was or where he went, please tweet us, hashtag safarilifequestions@wildebeests.tv. I'm always amazed when I hear people read out terms and conditions, how fast they're able to do it. You know, this hippo is also not looking in the best of condition. You can see his hips are starting. Ooh! He hasn't cleaned his teeth for a while either, has he, Davy? No. Ugh. That is awesome. Isn't that fantastic? Apart from the fact that he's closed his mouth on about, well, goodness knows how many liters of mud. Fantastic. You can just see the swizzling, swooshing. All of those things that look like sticks there, everybody, are catfish. Every single one of them. Some of them are at least 3 or 4 feet long. They won't be able to. I'm just listening. I heard what sounded like an alarm call. But we'll go and have a look. See, you will also be able to hear the, I find, very comforting sounds of a camp going into the evening. Kimberlion, you want to know if you think the catfish provide a sort of soothing massage for the hippopotamus? I imagine they do, you know. I think it must be. Once you're used to the feeling, once you've got over the feeling of those slimy things flapping against your body, it's probably, you know, if you just sort of let yourself into it, it's probably quite pleasant. Like when you put your foot in the mud in a sort of coastal river estuary and the fish start sort of swimming around. It's a little uncomfortable and disconcerting to start with, but after a while it becomes quite pleasant. There are also 2 or 3 African jacanas or lily trotter birds around. There's one coming just past the hippo there. You saw? There he is. And he or she, difficult to tell from here, will be just looking for little invertebrate snails, possibly a little bit of algae, but largely snails, and maybe tadpoles if you can find them, but I don't think there are going to be many tadpoles in here. That's the last deep bit of water in this massive, massive water body. So, definitely in for tough times here if you happen to be a hippopotamus. I was just saying the comforting sounds of the camp. Of course, these camps come to life round about now. Everybody's sort of coming back from the staff village in there. Pristine service outfits, and I always found it such a lovely time in the camp when I wasn't out in the bush. Carolyn, very nice question, an obvious one, of course, which I possibly should have addressed initially. What or how do hippopotamus keep cool when there is no water? And the answer, Carolyn, is they don't. They have to have water. They can try and lie in the shade. Sometimes they try and lie in the shade, but they really have to have water to survive. They cannot survive out of water. And, you know, there are fairly large areas of the Kruger where the hippo have been dying, and many hippo have died as a result of the lack of water around the place. So, yeah, they have to have water, Carolyn. So it's really a difficult time for them. He's opened his mouth again. There you can see his impressive nostrils.
Look at that. That is very cool, everybody. He's obviously a bit bored, scratching himself. He's been tickled by those catfish for too long. Stephanie, you say, would the hippo eat the greens in the pond? Yes, they do sometimes. It's not ideal forage. It's an exotic thing called the water hyacinth. And I have seen the hippo here eating it. But I don't think they do it out of choice. I think they do it more out of desperation than choice. They really do need grass. That's what they're designed to eat. But they will eat it in desperation. And I think he's probably got to the stage where he eats quite a lot of it these days. You also find with a lot of plants that aren't necessarily supposed to be eaten by the animal. So if an animal starts to eat plants that it's not really supposed to eat. Just listening to, never mind. I've just been listening to some jacanas, wondering what they were. What you find is that eventually the sort of compounds in that plant, which are its defensive mechanisms, which might not affect the animal trying to eat the plant initially, after a while, they do start to create a bit of a problem. And it's the same as if you eat too much of one thing, you start to not want that thing anymore, and that's your body's, it's not psychological, it's your body telling you that it's had enough of whatever is in there and it needs something else. And I think that would be much the case with the water hyacinth. I cannot believe how many catfish there are in there. It really is astounding. There's a lioness at Juma Dam, everybody. That's very good news. So Byron's on his way there. I'm pretty sure it would have been one of the lionesses that we were trying to track this afternoon. Just my luck that Byron's going to see it. Thanks for that, Louise. Now I'm not going to have to listen to him complain about my lack of success today. Just listen here, Dave. Can you hear that bird? Screeching sound of what sounds like an owl. I'm going to go a little bit forward. You can still watch the hippo, because I think the hippo may well come out. So let's just keep watching the hippo, and I'm just going to see if I can see what this owl is making the noise. And Louise, I'm going to assume that no one has mentioned where the lion went. Tasha, what you saw there was that hippopotamus just going to the loo, flapping his tail hither and yon. That's just what happens when they go to the loo. Normally they do it outside of the water, and that spreads the dung around, and it's their sort of territorial spraying. Now you want to know if they can sleep under the water, and if so, how do they breathe? They can't sleep under the water, they would drown. What they do is they stand in sort of, they will be in water that is maybe just slightly deeper than they are tall. And sometimes they'll doze off, sink to the bottom, then they jump, they sort of push themselves off the bottom, up again, breathe out, sink down again, jump up, and they sort of doze like that. But I think if they truly are fast asleep, they go into water shallow enough that they can stand in it. There he's coming out. It's very nice to see. So Louise, if you just won't, please confirm to me whether or not anyone has mentioned the lion and where he went. So labored they always look, but they are so fast when they want to be. But I mean, you can see exactly where that incredible song, Mud, Glorious Mud, comes from. And you can imagine a hippopotamus singing it. Isn't that cool? Now look how deep the mud is that he's sinking into. So it might look like you could walk across there, but you would sink very deeply into that mud, as he is, and that's why he's walking so very slowly.
And Mitch in New York, a very nice question, because we know that some animals do exactly what you've said. You said, do hippos ever get stuck in the mud and die from being stuck in the mud? I imagine it's happened, but I don't think it's common. I think it's probably very uncommon. They've got very splayed feet. You can see the splayed toes there. That helps them not to sink in too deeply. They've got those short legs, so they don't stick, you know, if they sink all the way up to the edge of the elbow joint there in the front leg, their legs are so short that I imagine they can probably pull them out if they have to. So unlike the impala or any of the antelope, which absolutely get stuck in mud like this, they've got those sort of very sharp pointed hooves with very long legs, and if you get one of those stuck badly, it's very difficult to get it out. And the hippo doesn't have that problem. Elephants get stuck in mud quite often, but normally just baby elephants. I think you'll find that hippo, because of their aquatic nature, are A, better adapted to it, and B, probably more capable of avoiding mud that's going to mire them. But you can see how gingerly he's walking. Very nice. Beautiful fellow. I'm trying to sex him. I'm pretty sure he's a male. Well, if he's a he at all, he's definitely a male, isn't he, Dave? It's normally how it works. I think that is a bull. I'm pretty sure it's a bull. All right, let's leave him to go grazing off towards the lodge, and we'll continue back towards home. Isn't that a lovely picture? Beautiful. Right. Brother Byron has arrived at Juma Dam, where the lion is sleeping.
We've just got you, James. We've just got to Juma Dam. So let's see that lioness. I caught a glimpse of her. She's just walked down into the dam itself. I'm trying to get around there quickly. So glad you had such a nice sighting of that hippo. It's always fantastic to see a hippo yawning and displaying. Hang on, sorry, little bumpy here. Where is she? There we go. And we've got her. And we've got her. Just down in the dam below us. Let me just get the spotlight. There we go. Oh, beautiful. Full belly. Wonder which lioness this is. I'm glad she drank so much water. That lioness definitely, she looks pregnant almost with a belly like that. Sure, let me see if I can have a look. I can hear the impala alarm calling in the distance behind us. Oh, that is fantastic. Let's follow her a little bit. Oh, she does look pregnant, that lioness. You can see her teats, and that belly is hanging quite low. It doesn't look like a belly which is full. Let's move a little bit closer, see where she goes. Amazing. These lions are popping out all over the show at the moment. I don't want to push her away too much. Sure, she has got a full belly. Hopefully full of cubs. Ah, there we go. Maybe she just stood on a thorn. That does happen occasionally. Can hear the monkeys behind us alarm calling too. They haven't quite gone to sleep just yet. It's amazing how incredible their eyesight is. They can pick up predators from quite far away. It's always a good idea to go and investigate if you hear monkey's alarm calling. Let's carry on down here a little bit. Let's see where she's heading off to. VM and I have been very lucky this afternoon. We have seen quite a lot. Some earth moving equipment. I think they've been doing some maintenance on the dams here at Juma while it's dry and they're able to. But hang on, this lioness is coming out. There we go. Hang on, I think she might come out in front of us around here. Let's just see. What a lovely sighting. This is interesting. And I mean, again, I don't know the blind dynamics in this area at the moment. This could be one of the Nkuruma females. Nkuruma females, I hope I'm saying that right. I understand there are five of them, and they have split up a little bit because there's potentially cubs on the way. It's amazing how quiet they are. Completely silent, but very happy to walk on the road. The reason for that is just, it's purely a nice pathway for them. It's easier than going off into the bush through the thickets because they do see it as a path, you know, branches. It's a little bit easier to move through. Gonna start up and just follow her a little bit more. Let's see which. So, Tasha has asked a question about that full belly, which I was mentioning earlier. Tasha, I do think she is potentially pregnant, and this female does look pregnant. Those teeth are very prominent and that belly is hanging very low. So in my mind, I mean, it does look like she's possibly full too, but that belly is hanging really low. It does look like she's pregnant. Those are definitely the teeth at the bottom look like they are full of milk at the moment. And those do build up and get larger when the females are pregnant. You can see, look underneath her belly there. Oh, this female's definitely pregnant. That is very exciting. Very, very exciting. Who knows? Very soon you could have little lion cubs running around. And Tasha has just asked us another question. If there are cubs, how many cubs would a lioness have? So Tasha, on average, well, it's generally anywhere between 1 and 3 cubs usually, or 1 and 4 cubs, but it's on average it's about 2 or 3 cubs. It does depend, but they can have up to 4 cubs. So one of the reasons why I think she is by herself is she's potentially looking for a den, and she's maybe left the rest of the pride fairly recently, and that could be why she's walking around. She just came down to for a drink of water. She obviously still needs to drink, but she's perhaps in search of a den at the moment, a den site, somewhere where it's safe, it's well hidden. Often they try and use rocky outcrops or thick drainage lines somewhere they can hide the cubs, and they will give birth to the cubs there and look after them for about a month and a half to 2 months before they probably introduce them to the rest of the pride. This is really fantastic. There she goes. You can hear a lot of nocturnal birds calling at the moment. In the distance, there is a bronze-winged courser, which is calling. There are scops owls, which have a beautiful call. It's a very strange call, but they'll call non-stop. If they're above your tent or room at night, they can make quite a noise for most of the evening. And it's a tiny owl. It's only about the size of your hand, very small. But they've got a distinct call. It sounds like they're going, grr, grr, grr. And they will call like that constantly for ages. So and they're heading down into this drainage line now up ahead. But still sticking to the road, again, just much easier for her to drive down, to walk down into the drainage line. It's easy for us to follow and drive down here. Yes. Stick with her a little bit longer. If she does move off into the thicket, I think we'll probably leave her. We don't want to disturb her too much, especially if she is pregnant or, you know, and looking for a den site. Maybe if we're lucky, as I mentioned, she may decide to den on Juma, which would be wonderful, and then we will be able to get to see some cubs over the next few weeks. Or within the next few weeks, once she brings them out of the den site. So Anna's asked a question about the lionesses and if they choose the den site before they give birth. Yes, and I'm sure they will. I think they will try and find an area. The other thing is, these lions, because they are the territorial pride, they know this area so well. So this lioness probably knows or has an idea in her mind where she would like the den site to be. So she will definitely have chosen that beforehand, and then when she feels she's ready to give birth, she'll probably hang around that area and give birth to those cubs and then carry them. I think James has a bush baby for you. Quickly go have a look while we follow the lioness.
We had a bush baby, everybody. I'm afraid I think he's jumped off. He did an amazing display for us. There's another one. What's this one here? This one is somewhere off in here. There's another one in there. There. You see it there, Davey?
That's
good. Middle of the light. Up, yeah. Right there, he's in the middle of the light.
I've got him.
This one we watched, everybody, jumped, sort of leapt like a gummy bear, of course, between, I don't know, maybe 10 or 15 trees, and came towards us, and then disappeared as you came to us. So well hidden there, that silver cluster leaf, isn't he? There, that's the other one calling. That's so unusual, you never hear them do that. Just in here, just behind this bush. Let me move a little bit forward.
on, Wendy. There. You see that, Dave? In the middle of the light. I've lost it now. It is there. There. You see it there? You're on it. It's right there. It's just almost impossible to see. There. You may just see the lights flicker. The ears, the eyes flicker. It's there, I promise. Let me go a little bit further forward. No, it's so hidden. We're not going to see it there, everyone. Let's go a little bit further forward to see if we can see the other one. There's the other one. The one was in one of these trees. I think there. Yeah, no, hiding behind the branch. I don't think we're going to see it, I'm afraid. I'm just going to scan through these silver cluster leaf trees and see if there's another one. There doesn't seem to be. Right, Byron's still with the lioness. Let's go back to him.
That's fantastic that you got to see a bush baby with James and to hear them calling. I have heard them before, but it's not something you hear very often. So I'm so glad you got to see and hear them. This lioness has continued along the road, still moving away from the Juma or Vuyatella waterhole. Oh, looks like she's heard or seen something up ahead. And I don't see anything, but their eyesight and their hearing is so much better than ours. She may have just heard something move through the bushes. Could have been a scrub hare, anything. And she'll just pick up her ears and have a look and see what it is. They are so alert and so aware of what's going on around them. We, as people and as human beings, our senses are nowhere near what these animal senses are like. We really are quite useless out in the bush compared to all the animals that we see, that we get here. So Monique in London has just asked us an interesting question about the lioness, and with her being pregnant, is she able to still hunt for herself, or does she go without food for a few days? And you can see those teats again hanging very, very low. So Monique, lions have a very, very short gestation period. It's only about 100 to 110 days. So it's not very long. During that period though, and especially at this stage, that lioness can still move very quickly if she has to, and she can still hunt for herself. If she doesn't hunt, she probably won't survive very long and probably won't have a successful pregnancy. So they do still hunt for themselves, but once she has given birth, she may take a few days just to recoup, look after the young, and then go off and hunt again. Often what they may also do is join the rest of the pride again, and hopefully the other lionesses will be able to hunt and she will get food from them because of that. But she will still hunt. She has to eat. She has to be healthy so that she can look after her cubs. But it is a good question. It is amazing how these animals, even though they are pregnant, they are still able to hunt and look after themselves. So James Richard, good evening to you. James Richard has asked, What is the most unusual place that I have seen or heard of a lioness denning? I'm trying to think, James Richard. I mean, I've seen rocky outcrops, thick, dense bush areas or drainage lines that are almost impossible to get into unless you are a lioness. I'm trying to think of any really unique places or strange places. Off the top of my head, I can't think of any, to be honest. I have heard of leopard denning under decks of lodges. So under wooden decks, they have been known to go under there because they feel safe and secure. And I have heard of leopards denning under there. I haven't seen lionesses. I don't think lions are that comfortable with people being around, especially when they have cubs. And it's also unusual for a leopard to den in an area like that. That is very unusual. So that would probably be, but again, not necessarily lions. I haven't heard of lions doing it. But right up on the top of rocky outcrops, you know, that are not easy to get to. Lions go right up there to give birth to cubs. Great that we're able to follow this lioness, but look how far she's walked already from drinking that water. Even though she's pregnant, she still covers huge distances. It just shows you, like, this afternoon James didn't have any luck in relocating those two lionesses that we had with that young buffalo calf kill, but you know, they could have finished it and then needed to drink water, and they will cover a huge distance to go and find water. Often, they, as I mentioned earlier, they do get moisture from the kill, but the blood in that is very salty, so the animals do get very thirsty after they have fed on a kill. They will then need to go for water, and usually, majority of the time, these predators will go and look for water so that they're able to drink something after they have a kill. At times, if it's a very large kill, so I just want to see what she's looking at. I don't see anything in the bushes here. So sometimes if it's a very large kill, hang on, what has she seen? Again, she may have just heard something in the bushes. So as I was saying, if it's a very large kill, predators, and I have seen them, especially lions, they will be feeding, and after a day or so they'll start moving and they'll go. I thought I heard something here. Hold on a second. Let me just have a look here. Something crashing through the bushes. I'm not sure if it was perhaps a buffalo that she may have startled, that smelt her or saw her and decided to turn and run. But there was definitely something large crashing through the bushes. I don't think it was an elephant. It did sound like a buffalo. I thought I heard a snort and a buffalo running off. But a lioness on her own, pregnant, chances of her hunting a buffalo by herself are very, very slim. So as I was saying, I've seen lions before feeding on something very large, and then what they do is they go off and they'll go and drink at a nearby waterhole and return. Often there'll always be one staying close to that kill to protect it and prevent other predators from coming in and stealing it or feeding on it. Lions don't like sharing their food with anyone. Ellen or James has just mentioned it's so funny to watch. She hasn't seen a lioness waddling like this before. It is funny. I've seen big male lions waddling when they have fed on a buffalo, and they're so full, their bellies literally like waddle from side to side, just like this lioness. But it is very funny to see. Carry on following this lioness just for a few more minutes while we've got the opportunity. It's really so special to be able to follow them like this, and we then have a better idea for tomorrow morning, or just even if we don't look for her in the morning, just to see which direction she's heading in, so that in the next few days we may come and investigate and see if we can't find any sign of her denning. See, even while she's walking, she keeps looking left and right, still very, very alert, always listening and watching out for what she might bump into. Lions are very opportunistic. If they happen to bump into potential prey, they'll go for it immediately. I've seen lions feeding on a wildebeest, and another one came running past, and they all jumped up and ran after the other one and tried to chase it, to kill it. And then they missed, unfortunately, but then they just then returned back to the kill that they had. But it's incredible how opportunistic they are. Even though they've got food, they will still try their luck. Let's catch up to her a little bit. Just going to scan a little bit while we are driving, see if I don't see anything else around. Again, my multitasking being tested here. Oh, the temperature has just dropped quite a bit as we've come down into this little drainage line. Temperature is much cooler. It's because the cold air sinks down into these areas. It's heavier than warm air. So it's much colder down here. But the nice thing, and especially in winter, you get these wonderful smells down here now. You get a plant called a potato bush. And the potato bush has this beautiful smell. It smells just like baked potato. And when you drive through these drainage lines, if there is one close by in winter especially, you pick up on the smell very, very easily and very quickly. Here we go. I think she's going to pop out here again. There she goes. Sticking to the road still just shows you she knows exactly where she's going. Just took a little shortcut through this little kink in the road, but straight back onto the road again. This has been such an amazing afternoon. We've had the herd of elephant, we had the cheetah, we had lions, James had that wonderful hippo and some bush babies for you. And that lioness is now moving off the road, so we are going to leave her and not disturb her anymore. I think we are going to say goodnight from James and David. They are on their way back to Jumana. And a big thank you to everyone for all the questions this afternoon. I hope you have enjoyed it as much as I have. Thank you to the ladies in the FC, Lou and Chelsea. Thank you to VM on camera for me today. It has been wonderful having you with us. Hope you've enjoyed it. And thank you to all the young viewers for your questions. Always great that you are watching. We will see you tomorrow morning, bright and early, on Safari Live.